Once upon a time, in the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, there lived a Slovak boy. His father was a diplomat and his mother was a diplomat's wife. The boy had no say in the matter of their strange travels, but even if he did, he would have gone regardless. The spice-filled food, the snow-peaked mountains, the colorful jingle trucks, all of the variations on the regular drumbeat of life in Bratislava would have pulled him in. Once the school year started and the question of a young man's education was raised, the boy was plunged into yet another foreign culture. In the sweltering heat of Islamabad's August, the Slovak boy started attending an American school. Behind mine detectors and watchtowers and tall walls of brick, the Slovak boy was introduced to American culture. His childhood was of ecto-coolers and doll, of scholastic book fairs and passionate cricket games, of pep rallies and terrorist drills. The boy was curious about the perplexing cultures that surrounded him, and he let that curiosity lead his path through life. The hunger for knowledge of others burnt like a shining torch inside of his belly. It drove him to ask questions, to embrace the unknown, to partake in the rituals from across the globe. But that fire was snuffed out. One Halloween night transformed the boy from a creature of curiosity to a creature of fear. It was the night he met the Jack-o-Mantern. When the cutout witches and ghouls were raised in a boy's homeroom class, he was confused. Back home, there was nothing spooky about October. People would fly their kites and rake their leaves, and sometimes a scary story or two would be told around the final campfires of the season. But no one dressed up. The Americans were different. For them, all of October was one long descent into the realm of ghosts and candy. Every week, more decorations would appear in the halls. Every day, a new scary rumor about the past of the school would float through the classrooms. Each moment of every class, anticipation grew. Something big was going to happen at the end of the month. There was, of course, no trick-or-treating. Whilst American suburbia lent itself to masked porch visitors, the streets of Islamabad weren't as kind. Each house had a gate, and each gate had a pair of guards with machine guns if the gate was ever to fall. Islamabad was a city of high walls, and behind those walls, one couldn't see ghosts. The administration of the school, however, refused to let Halloween go uncelebrated. Every year, on Halloween Day, the children would arrive to find the grounds of the school utterly transformed. The decorations were everywhere. One couldn't find a lawn without a spooky ornament, a wall without a cutout ghoul. The entire compound of the American school would turn into one big haunted house. Each classroom would be filled to the brim with candy that wasn't sold in the local stores. Sour heads and Skittles and Reese's Pieces. The sweets would be overflowing from the children's trick-or-treat bags. There was enough candy to give the children tummy aches for a month. And once the day's festivities were done, and all the fancy costumes were paraded around the school grounds, the whole school would meet inside of the auditorium and watch the Halloween classic Hocus Pocus. As October progressed, the Slovak boy got wrapped up in the American festivities. Every morning, he marked off days on his calendar until Halloween. His mother had sewn him a costume of dark green fabric so that he could go as the swamp monster. And each evening, he would parade the costume in front of his mirror, imagining himself in a parade of other masked children. If his new friends were to be believed, Halloween would be the biggest event of the year. But that year it wasn't. The first Halloween that the Slovak boy would spend in American school was spent at home. Credible bomb threats were made the morning of the celebrations. The administration didn't want to risk a disaster. The festive school day was cancelled. The boy would have spent a day alone in his house, but luckily, one of his new classmates lived across the street. When his friend showed up, he was already wearing his costume, a miniature Rambo with a soot-made 5 o'clock shadow waved from behind the gate. The Slovak boy jumped into his swamp monster disguise and greeted his friend. And so, a prepubescent Rambo and a roughly sewn swamp monster sat down for an afternoon of PlayStation 2 and Doritos. But it wasn't enough. Every conversation the boys had would inadvertently drift into their disappointment with the disappearance of that year's Halloween.
"We should at least summon the Jack-o'-Mantern,"
said little Rambo finally, after all the complaints had been exhausted.
"Who is Jack-o'-Mantern?"
the little swamp monster asked.
"No one really knows. Back home, they say that if you carve a pumpkin on Halloween, bleed on it, and say the words to summon him, the Jack-o'-Mantern would appear. He's some sort of Halloween ghost,"
said little Rambo. The Slovak boy smiled beneath his mask, excited for another nugget of culture.
What does Jack-o-Mantern do?
Asked the swamp monster.
He grants you a single Halloween wish, but you have to be careful what you wish for, because he's evil.
Said little Rambo.
Do you ever see Jack-o-Mantern?
Asked the swamp monster.
No.
Said little Rambo with sadness in his voice.
When I asked my mom for a kitchen knife to summon the Jack-o-Mantern, she yelled at me and told me I couldn't do it. Every Halloween, she would hide all the knives to make sure I didn't try.
For a second, the little Rambo's eyes drifted off, reminiscing on the Halloween disappointments of yesteryear. But then, as if all defeats could be forgotten, they locked onto the Slovak boy's pencil case. Little Rambo leaped at the school supplies, dug through them, and emerged with a sharp object.
We could carve a pumpkin and make ourselves bleed with this!
The protractor glistened in the hot afternoon sun.
Yes, let's summon Jack-o-Mantern,
the swamp monster shouted. A plan was quickly drawn up. The two boys would venture forth to the foreigner-friendly Kosar market, buy a pumpkin, and then perform the ritual in the nearby park. After getting permission to go outside from their parents, the two boys set out to summon the Jack-o-Mantern. If the Slovak boy had simply accepted he would have to wait another year for a proper Halloween celebration, he would have grown up to be a different person. He would have grown up to be a very different person. The pumpkin was small and lumpy, and the protractor served less as a carving knife and more as a dull chisel. But eventually, the two boys found themselves sitting in the shade of a cedar tree with something resembling a jack-o'-lantern. The protractor stung as it dragged across the little boy's palm, and its bloody trail made the little boy feel sick, but he convinced himself that a bit of pain was worth a new experience. Little Rambo cut his palm as well, and the two boys partook in a handshake. With a firm grip, their blood mixed and dripped onto the carved pumpkin.
Through three-sided eyes, we see your face.
Little Rambo started to whisper the words of the ritual.
Flickering candlelight, we do embrace. Jack-o-Mantern, Jack-o-Mantern, show your face. Bring us into your dark embrace.
At first, nothing happened. At first, it seemed like the American boy's little bloodletting was all drama with no tangible results. But soon enough, shouts could be heard coming from the market. Soon enough, the boys realized why the people were shouting. The trees shook like they were in the midst of a freak snowstorm. All across the neighborhood, dogs burst into pained howls. People ran from their homes and stared at their dwellings in fear. The ground was shaking. The earthquake lasted less than 15 seconds, but before it was over, both the boys were dialing their parents in sheer terror. All thoughts of Halloween were abandoned. The blood-covered jack-o'-lantern was left in the park as the two boys rushed home. Later that night, the little Slovak boy tried to make sense of it all. He laid in bed, watching the occasional gecko crawl across his wall, replaying the events of his first Halloween over and over. Had the American boy lied to him about the jack-o'-lantern? Did something go wrong with the ritual? Or did he simply misunderstand the story? The Slovak boy was disappointed with the lack of a manifested Halloween spirit. But that disappointment was easy to shrug off. He knew that the next day, another adventure would wait. Something new and exciting would come around. He was content on going to sleep with dreams of a brighter future looming in the horizon. But then his bed shook. For a split second, the boy was frightened, but then memories of his father's voice calmed his mind. It was just an aftershock. These things happened. They were nothing to worry about. Outside, the dogs let out a tired howl to commemorate another earthquake. But soon enough, the world outside went quiet. All that was left was the chirping of the crickets and the rustling of the gate. The rustling of the gate, that pleading metal groan from the outside world demanding to be let past the high walls of the boy's house. That creaking sound would stay with the boy for the rest of his life. Years of therapy haven't helped. The drinking hasn't helped. Nothing has helped. The shaking of those metal bars still haunts me every single moment of my life. Everything up until that point of my existence seems like a fairy tale, as if I was a passive observer in the adventures of a curiosity-filled youth. The moment I went out on the balcony, I replaced the little boy as the protagonist of the story, and that fairy tale turned into an endless fever dream. I remember walking out on the balcony in my Spider-Man pajamas. I remember the hot night air streaking past the air-conditioned chill of my room. I remember how warm the tiling felt beneath my bare feet.
What is your wish?
Raspy voice asked from behind the gate. Two beams of scarlet light focused on me from behind his roughly carved eyes. His hands, draped in mold-covered vines, shook the metal gate. Out in the street stood a man, wearing the pumpkin that was abandoned in the park. My blood, as if it was still fresh, dripped through the creases of the rotting fruit.
What is your wish?
The Jack-o'-Mantern demanded as he shook the gate. My blood ran cold. Each panicked breath that I took of the hot night air felt like a searing assault on my lungs. The scream in my throat refused to manifest. All I could do was stare into the light of his burning eyes.
What is your wish?
The Jack-o'-Mantern asked once more. His strained voice was accompanied by a metallic groan. The bars of the gate were starting to loosen beneath his vine-like hands. When in moments he was shuffling through my front lawn, moving his way towards my balcony.
Leave!
I finally managed to strain out.
Leave, leave, leave!
My throat was still seized with fright. I was barely able to speak past the whisper, but the Jack-o'-Mantern heard me. He stopped in the middle of my front lawn and spread out his arms.
Are you sure, young man? You only get one Halloween wish.
He said in a voice which echoed through my skull.
Leave!
I whimpered.
Leave, leave, leave! I never want to see you again!
The hole we had carved below the pumpkin's eyes barely resembled a mouth. But as the creature stood under my balcony, the opening grew into a sharp smile.
I will leave,
he said, through teeth of jagged orange.
But you will always see me.
His words slithered through the parts of my being which I didn't even know existed. The Jack-o'-Mantern's voice reached out and changed me as a person in my utter core. Looking into those bright holes of crimson, a dread which I had never felt before started to fester in my soul.
Happy Halloween,
he said. And then, as if it took no effort at all, his head exploded into a mess of viscera and pumpkin guts. I didn't hear the gunshot, but the rest of the neighborhood did. All the dogs on the streets burst into thunderous barks. Men with Kalashnikovs filled the streets, all the houses lit up with panic. Behind the headless corpse of the Jack-o'-Mantern stood one of our guards. His machine gun came clattering to the ground at the realization that he had killed someone. The scream in my throat finally manifested and dragged across the night. I never saw my American friend again. I never saw anyone from school again. The shock of what I had seen sent me to a catatonic state that condemned me to my room. I couldn't speak. I couldn't move. I couldn't think about anything other than the exploding mess of blood and seeds. After a couple days of me shivering in bed, barely able to eat past my chattering teeth, my parents decided I needed professional attention. Within a week, my Pakistani adventure was cut short and a long journey through Central European psychiatric hospitals began. There isn't a form of therapy I haven't undergone. There isn't a tranquilizer whose bitter taste hasn't lingered in the back of my throat. There isn't anything that I haven't tried to make the memories disappear. But decades later, he's still here. I still see him. I still see the Jack-o'-Mantern's exploding head from the corner of my eye regardless of where I am. The one thing I have learned is how to pretend I am sane. But that act never lasts long. Whenever I feel like I have just gotten back on track, like I can fit in with the society that I was ripped away from, his raspy voice will reemerge and remind me that there is no escape. My life is simple background noise to the constant explosion of death replaying in the back of my skull. He's always there. He's always looking at me. He's always dying. As constant as the Jack-o-Mantern's presence in the back of my head is, however, there is one night a year when he doesn't die. Halloween. Every Halloween, I see him from the corner of my eye. His head stays intact, and he speaks to me. Two words, repeated ad infinitum until they lose all semblance of meaning.
Happy Halloween! 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 Happy Halloween!